Let's go up.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Portsmouth City Council meeting of Tuesday, February 16, 2010, from the Eileen Dondero Foley Council Chambers. Before we get started, just ask the city clerk to call the roll, and I'm just moving a little slowly here to make sure everyone has an opportunity to be present and get started. So with that, we'll ask the city clerk to call the roll.
Mayor Farini?
Here.
Assistant Mayor Noveline Clayburgh?
Here.
Councilor Lister?
Here.
Councilor Hetmonic?
Here.
Councilor Spear?
Here.
Councilor Dwyer?
Here.
Councilor Coviello?
Here.
Councilor Kennedy?
Here.
Councilor Smith?
Here.
Thank you. I'll now ask Councilor Smith to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, preceded by a moment of silence.
Please join me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. At this time, I'd like to ask Police Chief Ferland to come forward with a presentation of police goals and objectives and comprehensive strategic plan for 2010 through 2015. Chief?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, city attorney, and the city manager. Thank you for this. I have a quick presentation for you about a two-year project that I'm very excited about because I perceive it to be our roadmap, our vision. Not since 1983 has the police department had a strategic plan to operate off of. 2 years ago, we started this process, which I'm about to review for you. 2 years ago, we started with a small focus group of various representatives from the internal side of the police department, union leaders, political leaders, and stakeholder group leaders. And the mayor and city manager were part of that first focus group. It was facilitated by the New Hampshire National Guard. And in there, we went over certain things like we started with, if you were to build a police department from scratch, what would it be like? It was just a dream police department as a way of starting off the discussion. Some of the things that this group came up with were some issues, external issues, in rank order that they thought the community was facing, that the police department should be addressing head on, and that is the rank order that they came up with in the order of importance for the community. We talked about our current mission statement, and one of the things that I want to reflect upon is the missions. The first police organization in the United States was the Texas Rangers, formed in 1835, and their mission statement at the time was to combat outlaws and Indians. Well, obviously, that's not their mission statement now, but at some time they needed to revisit their mission statement to make sure that it was contemporary and in line with what they were doing. Well, we too wanted to look back at our mission statement to see if it was contemporary and if it was going to be something that we wanted to keep with or something that we wanted to adjust. So we talked about the mission statement. We talked about a tagline of PORTS and came up with that. We weren't able to accomplish everything on our first group, and we asked the group to come back for a short 2 hours on July 23rd of 2008 just to work on our mission statement and our tagline. And this was some of the recommendation that they came up with. Now, remember that this is a two-year work in progress. A lot of this was draft form. It was designed to get ideas out in the open, to be creative, and to put ideas out on the table so that we could start discussing some of these things. We took all this information and all the ideas and the progress that we made so far, and we gave it to a facilitator who was a local resident who helps specialize organizations, who helps in specializing with organizations to come up with their vision, strategic planning. He works for Justice Works up at UNH, and we also employed the assistance of New Hampshire Police Standards and Training Council, because what we did is, if you remember in that first photo, there was a a U-shaped photograph of a whole bunch of people that was working around a computer, and police standards and training gave us all of those computers, and all those lines fed into one server. And I'll describe why we had that type of system for this next group. We had some very specific objectives, and what we were looking for, we had 20 people in that room, and we were looking for their ideas. And we came up with questions that we put into buckets. And this was one of the questions that we came up with is, if 24 people agreed with the mission statement, two did not agree with the first focus group's mission statement. So the first question was, well, for the two, what is missing from the mission statement? And then they came up with thousands and thousands and thousands of ideas. And this is how they came out with in the computer program. So imagine all those computers being fed into one server. Everybody had anonymous input. They can put anything that they wanted in relationship to the question. They can move back and forth to the different questions and put in anything that they wanted to put in. In the end, we got over 28,000 different words. We had 78 pages of dialogue back and forth. This was held at the Levinson Room, and it took place over the entire day. So in order to help look at all these words and to put them in some sort of rank order, the programming that we were using helps sort everything in rank order. So what you have is, this is an internal, for people internally in the police department, what is their most important thing? And by rank order, this is how they came up with the importance. And what these dots represent are the, the standard deviation. And what standard deviation means is the closer to zero that you get, the more the people were in agreement on as to where it should be in place. So for example, training is number one, but you can see that standard deviation suggests that it should be in the number one position as well. Not only did most people agree that training was important, but most people agreed that training is the most important thing. So then you go to the next one is professional development, improved team building. You can see where the standard deviation lies. So this is a pretty strong deviation. Anything under one in statistics is considered a very strong deviation, means very strong agreement. These are the external issues outside the police department in the community, what we should be focusing on, again, with your standard deviation. This is all of them put together, which is a whole lot, but it gives you a rough idea. If you just take the top third and work on the top third, that gives you an idea of what you can start from so that you can kind of get rid of all the other stuff and work off of what people are thinking is most important. Again, this is just another way of evaluating the input that's coming in from these different focus groups. Again, we're using computers to do a lot of the work for us. The next step comes to you. And actually the briefing that I'm giving you today. So you can see we've had our feedback loop begun with the citizens, the office, and the visitors with the feedback loop. It's already come to me and the police commission in draft form, and I'm going to be giving you a package at the end that you'll be able to read at your leisure and hopefully get some feedback, if you have some, back to the police commission, because it goes back to the police commission here probably in the next few weeks, hopefully for them to look at as possible policy. Then the feedback loop goes into the community, and then it starts all over again. Strategic visioning never ends. It continues to be developed over time. So this is a picture that we came up with. We're kind of looking to the future as to where we want to go, but we also have the knowledge of hindsight in the past, the insight present is where we are at now, but we want to move into the future. And remember, I have to present this to the police officers, to the community. There's a lot of people that I have to be able to present this. And sometimes visually presenting things is a lot easier than all that statistical data. So I tried to come up with different drawings, and the group came up with the different drawings that help represent that. So we took all the information that we had thus far, and we came up with this as a mission statement. And for the mayor and the city manager who were involved in the original parts of the mission statement, how we toyed over certain words and tried to figure out how to make a sentence flow well. We went so far as to ask notable authors to help wordsmith the lines so that we had good words in there. And this is what we came up with. And then, of course, we came up with three simple words to kind of cover the gray area in police work. We have stacks and stacks of rules and regulations, but you know what? They don't cover everything that we do. So when a police officer or an employee is dealing with a problem, we need to have something that fills in that gray area. And pretty much, if they work and they follow everything in the mission statement and they work for the community with compassion and with commitment, pretty much any decision that they're going to make is going to be a good decision. And that's what I mean about filling in the gray area. So we came up with 7 specific goals, 19 specific deliverables that are based off of those 7 specific goals. For example, here's one of the goals, and I'm going to brief you on community notification tonight. And you can see that over the last 2 years, we haven't been preparing police stuff in a vacuum of what we've been gaining from the different focus groups. We've been using the data that the focus groups have been giving us. Even though we haven't adopted it as policy, we were thinking that those ideas were really good, so we've been kind of implementing them. And in fact, you and the city approved in a capital improvement plan a reverse 911 system at the last year. And the city manager and us have been putting it together, and we're ready to give you a briefing on that as well. And with your indulgence, I'll give that to you at the end, a briefing on our community notification system. Again, our different goals with different deliverables underneath. This is, again, another visual aid. This is kind of like our tree, and with good selection and good training, nourished by good leadership, we will lead to empowerment. One thing we're finding with our new generation of police officers especially is that they like to be empowered. They like to be able to make the decisions. And we want them to make the decisions because the community actually wants us to be problem solvers, to be thinking outside the box, to coming up with good things. So good selection of officers and people, good training, good leadership will lead to empowerment, and then will bring us to excellence. Again, more goals and the deliverables under the goals. And you can see here, not to, we have the collective bargaining agreements as well, which we're all concerned about. And then we have our engage our citizen and visitors, our goal number 6. You can see we have the Citizens Police Academy up there already. And we also have different types of technologies to share information. And one thing that we really want to look at is there's a program out there called CopLogic. And Derry PD, I understand, just went to it. It is an online police reporting system that interfaces with our existing computer software. So if somebody is a victim of a theft, and it's a minor theft that doesn't require a police officer to go to the house or go to the scene, they can access the web and actually fill out the report themselves, and it then gets reviewed by a police officer and investigated in that manner. So we're going to be looking at that type of technology. And again, we want to solicit feedback from the community, because right now, the way we get feedback from the community at the police department currently is through a passive system, meaning that we have an open door and we want people to give us feedback, and we get phone calls and we hear that feedback. We got people who walk in the station and give us feedback. People write letters to the editors, give us feedback. You give us feedback. But we want to go to a more active system as well. We're actually doing more surveys, anonymous surveys, telephone surveys, things like that, so we can get to that person who might be the wallflower, who might be, you know, just too busy to try to give us the feedback. So I want to give you that handout, and if you don't mind, Mr. Mayor, I might approach the bench and I'll
please
give you the handout.
Thanks, Chief.
Good, Chief.
Thanks, Lou. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Sir, if you don't mind, I'd like to begin with the community notification real quick.
Please do.
To go over that. Again, just starting off, last year under the capital improvement, one of the programs that was appropriated was a reverse notification system. Excuse me. This is a phone recording callback type of system, meaning that we can call the various members in our communities. This program is ready to roll. All department heads have been trained in the program now. The policy has been developed for the use of it. The product has been tested, and right now, all it's waiting for is a green light to actually put it online. First off, when would we use it? And then I'll get into what it is. We would use a callback system, and what I mean by a callback system is a pre-recorded phone call or a text that we can do that would go to approximately 80% of the hardline phone numbers that are already in the database. Not all phone numbers are in the database. For example, unlisted numbers, cell phone numbers, and some business lines are not in the database. And I'll explain how people can opt in and opt out a little bit later. But we would be able to send a pre-recorded telephone message to those roughly 8,500 phone lines that are already in the database. And these are some of the instances where you could be making these phone calls into that system. And the whole idea is to keep the citizens involved. It is part of our emergency preparedness, and I don't know how to actually get the audio, but I have a sample audio.
This is an urgent message from the Anytown Police Department. We're currently looking for a fugitive from the law believed to be armed and dangerous in your area. The person's name and description is John Smith, a 34-year-old, white male, 6 foot tall, 200 pounds, brown eyes, black hair. Last seen wearing a white polo shirt, blue jeans, black sneakers. Believed to be in a 5 mile vicinity of 123 Main Street. We need your help. If you have information about this fugitive, please call the Anytown Police Department at 407-555-1212. That's the Anytown Police Department at 407-555-1212. Please keep your children and elderly indoors as he is believed to be armed and dangerous. Thank you for your help.
So this message could be tailor-made for anything. It could be made for a missing child, it could be made for a hazardous spill, it could be made for emergency road closure, it could be made for snow removal, it could be made for anything that the city decides it wants to make a notification to its citizens on. Right now the plan comes with 30,000 minutes a year, and how the minutes work is if you do 10,000 phone calls and the message is 30 seconds, that's 5,000 minutes. So that's how it would work, and that's how your bank would wear down. However, all emergency minutes are free. So ice storm emergencies, or for example, over the weekend we had the carbon monoxide incident over at the Hilton, and there were a lot of people around that area who were wondering what was going on and flooding the communications with what's going on. I see an awful lot of ambulances. I see the helicopters. There was a lot of activity going on. We could make, you can see the circle here around Elwin Park, we can make a geo file. We can just outline a specific area, and it will just phone those lines in that within that circle. So we could have easily made a circle around the Hilton, going around, and made a pre-recorded conversation saying this is what the activity is about. Make 6,000 phone calls per minute, so it can get Portsmouth done in about 2 minutes, all of Portsmouth. So it's a nice, quick system for us. People can opt in and opt out, and this is very important for the citizens to know. For example, I have a cell phone. Cell phones are not automatically recorded. However, I'm going to want to receive the emergency notifications. So I can go online, I can come to City Hall in person, I can call up, I can fill out a form, and opt in. There's a small, short verification process just to make sure that, you know, somebody's not putting in a fictitious phone number or a harassing phone number. But people can opt in. They can also opt out, meaning if they don't want to get any notifications from the city, they can opt out with the same system. They can get online, they can come to City Hall, they can fill out the form, they can call up, and they can opt out their numbers as well. So they can add numbers, they can take numbers out if they want to. It's a completely secure system. The next step that we're at is the media campaign. And before we go out to the public on this, we figured that the next step is going to be you guys, because your constituency may be calling going, what's going on? Plus it's recorded, plus hopefully the media will be covering this. And we want to start getting word out about what this program is. so that when they get their first call, we would do a test phone call, which is part of the system and it's free, a test phone call to make sure that they're getting the phone call. It could be used in simple things like, you remember when we had the Seabrook sirens? We could have easily put a message out going, that's just a test. Or when the Navy Yard's having their cannon shooting, and we get all kinds of phone calls from the South End going, what's going on? You know, they're just shooting a ceremonial cannon. We can notify the South End that there's going to be a ceremonial cannon firing, things like that. But before we do that, we want to make sure the community is adequately notified about this system so they don't think it's a prank phone call. Other parts of this system are, if the line's busy, it'll call back up to 3 times. If someone dials back the last number, say they don't answer it, and they see the last number and they redial the last number, it'll automatically play the message. It's a very nice system to be able to use. There's literally thousands of communities across the country who are using this system. It's a system that comes out of Florida, Georgia, and North Carolina. That's their redundancy. So no matter really what area of the country might be under a disaster, we are still relatively secure to know that this system here will be able to get work, will be able to get used. So there's nice redundancy in this system. That's all I have on code red.
Thank you very much, Chief. Thank you for the informative presentation. And if there are no particular questions, we do have a question. Councilor Spear.
Could I ask questions about the strategic plan,
Sure.
This is my first time seeing a strategic plan for a department, and I just want to say I think it's wonderful.
Thank you,
and,
sir.
And I hope some of the other departments in over the years take the same type of approach. But I had some questions, so I wondered if I could ask some. I liked the way you had all the goals that would lead to actions, you know, broken out, and I thought that was wonderful. And the way you used focus groups to get the kind of qualitative information internally about the department. One question I had related to that, I didn't see a lot of, or any, quantitative measures. And I wanted to know if, as part of your strategic plan, you had developed some benchmarks or any type of quantitative measures to measure how well you're succeeding with your mission statement.
That's a very good question. For example, one of the deliverables, for example, is to do our ride-along program better right here. Right now, we currently, and to give you a measurable, one of the things we do right now is we already have a ride-along program. So you go, why do you have a ride-along program up here? Because the way we're doing the ride-along program is we're not capturing good stuff. For example, we should be doing a survey before folks take their ride-along. And then we should be doing a survey after they take their ride-along to get some sort of measurable results. How effective was that ride-along? And then what we wanted to do was, 6 months later, ask them to redo another survey to see if their thoughts had changed, if their opinions had changed, if their focus had changed at all. So that's one way that we were going to be able to measure. Now, still, I know what you're getting at. A lot of it is still qualitative because it's people's emotions and feelings. But you can kind of quantify it a little bit by asking them to, you know, rate it on a scale of 1 to 10, you know, what their thoughts were going into it, what their thoughts are coming out of it, something like that, so we can do specific measurables. But you're right on. I mean, a lot of police work anyway is qualitative. It's not quantitative.
And then
an additional question.
Yeah, thank you. The when you were going over this, all of the focus groups were all internal, and I was, well, when are they going to involve the community? And I see then that's the next step. So that was wonderful. I was glad to see that, and you'll involve all the various stakeholders to the process. And so I was glad to see that. So that's all I wanted to say.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Anyone else at this time? Well, somebody, Councilor Smith.
Thank you. Thank you for the report, but I also want to point out in our packet, we have the Citizens Police Academy. Last year, I took the Citizens Police Academy along with Councilor Panalakis. It was an excellent program, a lot of information, and I was able to get a lot more understanding of what the police department does, especially since we work on their budget. And so I'd personally like to challenge at least two councilors, current counselors, to take this course. You'll gain considerable knowledge about what it is they do each day. And I'd really like to see at least two counselors take that course this year. It is free. It is paid for by Crime Stoppers. They do the fundraising. It does not cost taxpayers money. and it's a great program.
Thank you, Council Smith. Any further comments or questions? Thanks a lot, Chief.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
We move on now to item 5, which is approval of the minutes of February 1st, 2010. Do we have a motion in that regard?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
None opposed, and that is unanimous. We now move on to the public comment session, not to be confused with the public hearing sessions, which are also on for tonight's agenda. The public comment is an opportunity for people to speak regarding city business or any other particular topic for 3 minutes, and people sign up. And at 2 minutes and 30 seconds, when you come forward after having identified yourself by name and address, the city attorney will indicate that you have 30 seconds remaining. And when you see the thank you card raised, you will know that you have reached the end of 3 minutes. We have two speakers this evening. Our first is Richard Gamester.
Thank you, Mayor Farini. Council members, Bob Sullivan, city manager. I speak this evening in reference to an ordinance or a part of the charter that was done a couple of years ago, I believe, regarding art in buildings, art in new buildings, as if I'm specifically correct. And I believe it's 1%. John, if I'm correct on that?
There's a provision that has
1% of the cost of construction. I'm speaking tonight as a fire commissioner. In this particular time, economic forecast, economic outlook, recession, whatever you want to call it, maybe this one time, the cost of the fire station number 2, and before we get into the position of spending money on that, maybe we should reconsider at this time spending those dollars. Maybe we can set them aside, spend them at another time. The only thing that the commission would like to have is the present form of art, which we commonly call Rusty, now sitting at Station 2, moved to the new station and resettled in there and give them a new home and new lights and a little bit of warmth and welcoming there. If I know the money can't be used to settle budgets or to settle contracts, it's probably going to be used to reduce funding, budget, not budget, John, give me the right word, bonding issues. That's all I would ask tonight, is to reconsider that particular action. Thank you.
Thank you. Our second speaker and last speaker under public comment is Heather Hurt.
Good evening. Heather Hurt, 69 Newcastle Avenue. I want to comment tonight on the city's recommendation to close the indoor pool. As a taxpayer and a member of the rec board, I heavily support investing taxpayer dollars in indoor recreation and aquatics. We live by the ocean, and it's really critical that everyone in the community can swim. Swimming is extremely popular in our region. Last summer, the indoor pool saw 25,000 visits, and that's despite losing 10 days to poor weather and not offering open swim during the weekday mornings. Water offers the most diverse recreation fitness opportunities, from competitive lap swimming to people on a swim team to aqua aerobics for older adults, to water play for kids. It's physical therapy is now increasing in being able to offer that in water. So whether you're 70 years old, 4 years old, or somebody with an injury, you can recreate in water because it's low impact. With that said, I want to publicly say tonight that I agree that investing $1.2 million for repairs in a standalone traditional lap pool that has exceeded its life cycle and requires more than a 70% subsidy of its operating costs on an annual basis is not the most effective, strategic, and smart way to meet the aquatic needs of our community. This is especially true when there are communities around the country, for example, Lafayette, Colorado, similar medium income, similar population, that are building highly energy efficient, consolidated, multi-generational aquatic and indoor rec centers that offer competition lap pools, warm water leisure pools. They've got daycares, fitness centers, and gyms. And they're doing this with only a, 30 to 40% taxpayer subsidy of the operating costs. So I think there are better models out there that we really need to look at. As a community, I think right now we have a huge opportunity to create a smart and strategic plan and indoor and long-term vision for indoor recreation and aquatics. And also to essentially decide what is the role of government going to be in implementing that plan and that vision. To this end, I want to urge all the council members and residents out there to attend the Comprehensive Rec Studies presentation and public input session this Thursday at 6:30 p.m. in at the high school. Let's just make sure we don't close the indoor pool and not have a long-term plan and a clear commitment to the future of aquatics and indoor recreation in Portsmouth. Thank you.
Thank you. And we have, we pulled the sheet just a little early, so we have one other individual in public comment. Eric Anderson, if you want to come forward.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, council members. My name is Eric Anderson, 38 Georges Terrace, Portsmouth. I know tonight's meeting doesn't focus on budget issues for fiscal year 2011. But these comments are based from just developing observations that are unfolding as each department tries to prepare and submit their budget requests. Currently, some of the budgets have been exposed and have received a variety of comments, either pro or con. I think what perplexes me, and maybe hopefully other council members, is that the budget requests and the reductions requested by the City Council have been presented as one-option plans. That plays a lot on the emotional responses of the public when it starts to get into personnel cuts, program cuts, so on and so forth. I think that's what's been presented and has been observed, at least in my public observations of what's been presented now. It's starting to create some very emotional responses. I just think that with whatever the council can do in dialoguing with the departments that are going to be part of this process, that they come up with more than one plan, more than one option that might be considered and reviewed by the council, by the public. This is going to be a huge issue, and there's just perspective collisions that are going to take place in the course of the process as it gets closer. So as early on as possible, I don't know exactly, what the process is and how the council dialogues with departments, but I think it should be emphasized that more than one option is presented for consideration. The problem is huge. There is more than one solution for the answer. I think this should take place as early as possible. I'll just make one observation. If there's consideration to revisit current approved contracts, then that should start as early as possible. If that provides a solution in some of the budget problems that are going to be unfolding, that should be started as soon as possible in some way, shape, and manner, either by the school department or the city council, whoever is the prospective responsible party that actually has signature the contract. This is my comments today are just based on observations that I think are unfolding, and as much that can be done by the council to have more than one option solutions for the public and you to consider, I think is going to benefit all. Thank you.
Thank you. And that is the end of the public comment session. We now move on to public hearings, not to be confused with the public comment. And the first is there are four before us this evening, two regarding the maximum income limits for individuals qualifying for elderly and or disabled real estate tax exemptions. And I'll call one and then the other, but I will say, as I have given notice from the chair prior to the end of last year, that It had typically been our practice to call three rounds, allowing people to speak three times, and I will no longer be following that procedure unless the City Council, for some purpose, votes and seeks to have that be done. And so with that, I'll call the first item, which is a resolution increasing the maximum income limit for individuals qualifying for the elderly real estate tax exemption to $33,182 for single and $40,933 for married, and total assets may not exceed $110,611, whether single or married. So I'm going to open the public hearing. If anyone cares to speak, please come forward. You may speak for as long as you wish. Please, I would ask that you be mindful of your other citizens who may also wish to speak. And with that, I open the public hearing. Seeing no one rise, I will close the public hearing on this item. We now move on to item B, which is a resolution increasing the maximum income limit for individuals qualifying for the disabled real estate tax exemption to $33,182 for single and $40,933 for married, and total assets may not exceed $110,611, whether single or married. And with that, I will open the public hearing. Does anyone care to speak? Seeing no one rise, I will close the public hearing. And I'll move on to item C, which is a resolution authorizing a bond issue of up to $1,800,000 for fiscal year 10 citywide facilities, streets, sidewalks, and bridge improvements. I will open the public hearing for people who wish to speak to this resolution. Does anyone care to speak? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing on this bonding issue and move to item D, the last of the items on for public hearing. This is a resolution authorizing a bond issue of up to $500,000 for fiscal year 10 school facilities improvements. And I will open the public hearing if anyone cares to speak to that item. We have a speaker. Please come forward, state your name and address for the record.
Good evening again. My name is Eric Anderson, 38 Georges Terrace, Portsmouth. I didn't recognize this was going to be on the agenda, but just knowing that I've had some interest in it, I also would want to try and present a question for clarity. I just might not know that my comments are being directed correctly. Is this $500,000 bonding some of the discretionary spending that the school department is subject to, or is it part of the CIP?
In consideration that there's virtually no one here to speak at the public hearing, we're going to have the city manager respond in the interest of clarity, though that is typically not a procedure we can engage in when we have a busy public hearing. John?
Thank you, Your Honor. Mr. Anderson, what this will do is, this is from last year's public CIP, and as we described, whenever the capital improvement plan is approved, if it's identified as a bonding item, even though it's approved in the plan, it has to come through the City Council for two readings, a public hearing, and two-thirds vote. This particular item was identified on page 54 and 55 of the CIP from last year, and it is for the replacement of the bleachers at the athletic complex and for the replacement of the remaining roof at the Dundero School.
Thank you. That makes clarity a little better. I know that. In recollecting the CIP budget last year, it was a multi-task appropriation. I would just wonder if it's within the consideration of the council now to and whether they even can, because with part of the last year's CIP plan, to revisit some of the itemized spending or expenditures for this $500,000. I'm not sure. You know, I can see credibility with some of them, as I recollect, is school facility improvements, new roof on Dundero, the bleacher issue. I believe that was cut out about $250,000. There was $250,000 designated for that, and if that's appropriate, so be it. If those bleachers are, you know, condemned, but I think in light of some of the bonding issues that taking place now and are going to come forward in the 2011 appropriation process, and looking out into the bonding issues that are going to accumulate in the out years, I don't know if there's ability to revisit that, maybe redesignate it for, you know, a more worthy purpose, because I think things have escalated the issues that were passed last year in the CIP, I think those issues have escalated to concern with what you're going to have to be contending with in fiscal year 2011. If I recollect correctly, and it was appropriately stated by the city manager, the economic conditions that are unfolding or unfolded, you know, probably had a lag time of 18 to 24 months for municipal purposes. And I think that's almost fitting within the time frame of when this was approved in the CIP last year. I'd only ask that whether it's worthy of conversation to see that all the projects that this $500,000 is designated for are still appropriate 12 months later and coming up to 18 or 24 months with you know, bonding issues that are going to be coming forward. It's not a big ticket item, but as somebody has said, if you watch your pennies, the dollars will follow. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else care to speak on this item? Seeing no one rise, I'll close the public hearing and move on to item 8 of your agenda, approval of grants and donations, the first being acceptance of donations to the Coalition Legal Fund from the Town of Freedom in the amount of $1,000 and the Town of Waterville Valley in the amount of $1,000. Do we have a motion to approve and accept?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you and thank you. Discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous. Next, we have an acceptance of donations for Art Speak, DeWitt and Nancy Carmer for $50, and Tom and Annabelle Cucciaro for $100. Do we have a motion to accept and approve?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? Seeing no one seek to speak. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
None opposed? That's unanimous. Item C, acceptance of grant from the state of New Hampshire for the New Hampshire Arts Satellite Network pass-through funds from the state of New Hampshire in the amount of $10,000. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Okay, the motion to approve and accept. Do we have a second?
Second.
Discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed? That's unanimous. Item D, acceptance of Art Speak overnight art sponsorship. First is Bid to Win Software, Inc. for $5,000, George Fries for $750, Boson and Springer PLLC for $500, ArtStream LLC for $100, and Susan J. Conway for $100. Do we have a motion to accept and approve?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Councilor Smith and Councilor Dwyer for the second. Discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed? That is unanimous. We now move on to item E, which is an acceptance of a grant for Art Speak from the New Hampshire State Council on the Arts in the amount of $6,900. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed, and that passes unanimously. We now move on to item 9 of the agenda, consideration of resolutions and ordinances. Item A is adoption of resolution increasing the maximum income limit for individuals qualifying for the elderly real estate tax exemption to $33,182 for single and $40,933 for married, and total assets may not exceed $110,611, whether single or married. Do we have a motion to adopt this resolution?
So moved. Second.
Motion made and seconded. Discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Chair votes aye. None opposed. Item B, adoption of a resolution increasing the maximum income limit for individuals qualifying for the disabled real estate tax exemption to $33,182 for single and $40,933 for married, and total assets may not exceed $110,611, whether single or married. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion, duly seconded. Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And none opposed? That passes unanimously. We now move on to an adoption of a resolution authorizing a bond issue of up to $1,800,000 for fiscal year 10 citywide facilities, streets, sidewalks, and bridge improvements. And does anyone care to make a motion to adopt the proposed bond?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Do we have discussion? Councilor Kennedy.
Just for clarification for everyone, that each project will come forward and have to be voted on, right?
No. Once this is adopted, then they move forward.
Okay.
Further discussion or inquiry? If not, this will be a roll call vote. So And as you know, it's a bonding vote, so we'll need six in order to pass it. Four against to defeat. And with that, did I get my math right? I did. Ask the city clerk to do the roll call vote.
Assistant Mayor Novelin Clayburgh?
Yes.
Councilor Lister?
Yes.
Councilor Hetmanic?
Yes.
Councilor Spear?
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Coviello stepped out. Councilor Kennedy?
Yes.
Councilor Smith?
Yes.
Mayor Farini?
Yes.
So unanimous.
Passes unanimously. We move to item D. Adoption of resolution authorizing a bond issue of up to $500,000 for fiscal year 10 school facilities improvements. Do we have a motion to adopt that proposed bond resolution?
Move to accept.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Discussion. Councilor Kennedy.
Maybe we can have some clarification on the bleachers. I understand the roof, but is the bleacher something we really need right now?
I had asked Steve Bartlett to be here, but he's under the weather today. So I'll see if Steve, could you come down and maybe speak to this issue if you have some information on it? I know Steve has been working with him. unfortunately, Steve is ill today.
I know over the past few years there have been safety issues associated with the bleachers that are at the high school, I believe the project is. And this is to address those issues. There's areas where children can slip through the bleachers and fall through. And I know that is the primary reason for the replacement of these bleachers, because they just don't meet current codes.
Any further questions? Councilor Kennedy.
Do you know how much the whole, I know they've been doing a lot of work up at that facility, how much the new building that they did cost?
Which building in particular are you referring to?
Where they were doing all the announcing and stuff.
Oh, the press box.
Yeah, the press box. Thank you.
I believe it was under $50,000.
Okay. And that included the building itself?
That was the building on top. They retained the existing structure that was in place. In order to go any bigger, then they would have had to replace all the structural components underneath it. So that was what was appropriate for the size of their current structural supports.
And did that include the PA system and all electronics to it, for the $50,000?
I believe that was strictly the building itself.
Any further questions or discussion? Thank you, Steve. So we have another bonding resolution before us. Ask the city clerk to engage in a roll call vote.
Assistant Mayor Novelin Clayburgh?
Yes.
Councilor Lister?
Yes.
Councilor Hetmanic?
Yes.
Councilor Spear?
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Coviello has stepped out. Councilor Kennedy?
Yes.
Councilor Smith?
Yes.
Mayor Farini?
Yes.
Unanimous.
We now move to item E1, the third and final reading of ordinance amending Chapter 7, Vehicles, Traffic, Parking, Omnibus Ordinances. The first ordinance and sample motion would be if we were to pass the final reading, we would pass it as amended, I got a little spaced out. We'd be passing third reading amending the ordinance. My apologies.
Correct. So moved.
We have a motion. Thank you. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a second. Discussion. Councilor Kennedy.
Over on Richards Ave, when I was living over there in a duplex, there was a discussion made about when the loop, a lot of people had to park, a lot of those duplexes had to park in the old JFK Center. And there was a discussion about the library being placed there, and with the residents sitting there, they said that, and it's predominantly an issue during snowstorms, that people would still be able to park there. Now, I know there was a discussion, and the discussion was that it might not be in the very front lot, and I also know there's been some issues over there between the librarian and some of the citizens about parking in that front lot. So will we mark the side lot to say that there will be parking for residents or for 72 hours or some kind of notification so that those individuals, since I think that was part of the discussion, that they could park in the side lot of the library, and particularly during snowstorms?
Is Do we have anyone who might be able to respond to that inquiry?
Speak to that,
if you wish,
Your Honor?
If you wish.
When you say the side lot, Counselor, you mean where the center lot is between the middle school and the library?
Whatever the discussion took place,
right.
there was a plan.
That was where we were. There was discussed that they would park, and they would have to. You know, it's a little bit more walk than in that space that's actually in front of the library. In terms of signage, I don't know what kind of signage we'd put in there, other than I think people know that they can park there. I don't know. I have not had that conversation with anybody. The only conversation that we have had is with regards to the lot in front of the library. With regards to signage, I mean, we're open to, if the council would like it, we could. I mean, it's something maybe the parking committee can take a look at. But more signage, I think people are well aware that they can park there. But if signage, I don't know what it would say, but we could always internally look at it if that's something the council wants me to do.
I think it would clarify. In talking to a few citizens from that street, I guess there has been some conflicts, and it might clarify so that there will be no longer conflicts taking place between the library staff and the citizens over in that neighborhood if they knew where they could park.
Councilor Dwyer.
But how could we allow people to park there for 72 hours if it's an active middle school library lot? That's what I don't see how that. I think that's what you're raising. I mean, it wouldn't, you couldn't do that.
No, we would tow them, wouldn't we?
No, it's a public lot. It's a public lot. I think the thing is, it is a public lot. But why don't you give us the opportunity to talk about it in the parking committee and see if we can come up with some kind of signage or some kind of, you know, informational flyer or something that we can give to the neighborhood. So, because we're going to have to do that anyway with the middle school. We're going to have to figure out some of that. So why don't I do this? We'll talk about it at the next parking committee meeting and see how we can better either inform people or sign it. I don't know, and we can talk about that internally.
Further inquiry or discussion?
No, I think that would be to clarify so that we don't have any of the conflicts that I've heard have transpired over there. It would be nice to clarify that and keep that in mind, that those citizens were told that something would be taken care of.
Okay, I'll talk to the chairman of the committee, and we'll put it on the next agenda.
Thank you.
And also to comment on that, if there have been conflicts out there, if they could let us know on the parking committee so that we can try to, you know, clarify any issues as well.
I think John has some information we can talk about.
Thank you.
Great. Further discussion, or are we ready to vote? Seeing no one offer forth, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
None opposed, that's unanimous. We now move to the third and final reading of the ordinance amending Chapter 7, Vehicles, Traffic, Parking, Omnibus Ordinances. This is the second ordinance, and we're passing, we would be moving to pass third and final reading of this proposed ordinance. Does anyone care to make a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Councilor Smith.
Second.
We have a second discussion. Does anyone care to speak? Seeing no one so move, call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? That is unanimous. We move to the consent agenda, but since it's one item, I'll just read it.
One more.
I missed one. Sorry about that. Thank you. Third and final reading of the ordinance amending Chapter 6, Article 13, Section 6.1307, Prohibited Conduct, Vendor from Motor Vehicle. Does anyone care to make a motion to pass third and final?
So moved.
Thank you, Councilor Smith.
Second.
Seconded discussion. Councilor Coviello, did I see you offer? It's not an auction, I guess. All right. Seeing no one wish to speak on this one, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed? That's unanimous. Item 10, consent agenda. There's one item, and I'll go forward with that. A letter from Doug Bates and Joan Chosiak, Greater Portsmouth Chamber of Commerce, requesting permission to hang the Portsmouth Harbor Trail flags at 24 key sites for the 2010 season. And typically, given that this requires some regulation by city staff or view, we'd move this to the city manager with power. Does anyone care to make a motion?
So moved. Second. To accept the consent agenda.
Okay, we have that motion to adopt. That is the preferred action for the city manager. Do we have any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? That's unanimous. We move on to presentation of consideration of written communications and petitions, of which there are none. We go to item 12, reports and communications from city officials, city managers, items which require action. City Manager Bohenko.
Thank you, Your Honor. The first item deals with approval of an easement for the Lafayette Road Fire Station. The city has been informed that Public Service of New Hampshire is requiring an easement from the city to allow utility poles and underground services to power the new fire station on Lafayette Road. It appears that the deed that the pole is on Ocean Road, and the city attorney has provided a deed from a PSNH and feels it's appropriate for us to enter into this easement.
You've heard the explanation by the city manager. Do we have motion to authorize him to execute the agreement for the easement, or execute the easement?
So moved.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Discussion. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
None opposed? That's unanimous.
Thank you, Your Honor. The next item deals with the request to renew a lease agreement for the Sons of Italy. I've attached a copy of a letter from the Sons of Italy, Seacoast Area Lodge 2303, requesting renewal of their lease at 1 Plains Avenue for a one-year extension effective April 1st, 2010 through March 31st, 2011. The city attorney has drafted up a revised lease agreement. And they have been, holding annual open houses at the Sons of Italy as requested by the City Council to have some public availability of the building. I believe, Your Honor, you've been able to attend those.
I have.
And they are asking for that extension for 1 year.
We need a motion to put it on the floor for discussion.
So moved.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
I'll just say at the commencement of what might, you know, the discussion on this, that I must disclose that I am an honorary member of the Sons of Italy, though I do not actually hold or pay membership. So I don't intend to recuse myself on this one unless someone cares to call it into question. With that, further discussion on this issue. I also ate various food items at the open house. And I'll disclose that as well, but I did pay. Any further discussion? You probably figured that out anyway. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed? That's unanimous.
Thank you, Your Honor. The next item deals with a request from the Seacoast Growers Association for renewal of their license for the farmers market here at City Hall. A copy of a letter from the president of the association is attached requesting the renewal. And we have, working with the city attorney's office, the health department, and other agencies of the city, put together a license agreement. You might want to note that we've also added a paragraph regarding zero waste. We have from the Sustainability Committee their commitment to work with the farmers market, with the Seacoast Growers Association, on working towards zero waste from the market. And we ask that the City Council approve this agreement with the Seacoast Growers Association.
Okay, and we have our letter from Celeste Gingras, who I think is here. Welcome. Does anyone care to make a motion?
I'd like to make a motion to authorize the city manager and enter into a license agreement.
Second.
Discussion. Council Kennedy.
Is there any thought of, I went to the farmers market over and at Exeter High School. It was very nice. It was kind of a nice tribute between the high school and the communication and the community. And I was wondering if there's any thought of looking at some kind of market during the winter in the Portsmouth area.
We can talk. I don't know what the Seacoast Growers Association has in mind, but it's something that I can inquire of them.
I'd be kind of curious because the Rye has one, Exeter has one, Newmarket has one. There's a lot of nice ones around, and it'd be nice if Portsmouth looked into it, I would think.
Okay.
Celeste, if you want to write us a letter, be most welcome. Okay. Any further discussion on that? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous. Item 4.
Thank you, Your Honor. We have a number of items that I'm going to ask the planning director to come down and speak to regarding license agreements for projecting signs. The first one deals with Fast Eddie's Dirty Laundry for a property located at 123 Market Street to install a projecting sign. And what I'd ask, Rick, is maybe you could walk through all of these while
sure.
You're up there.
Yes. The next three items, 4, 5, and 6 on the agenda, are all fairly straightforward. They're the standard projecting sign that comes before you periodically. There are no issues with any of these, and the planning board has recommended in favor of granting a license with the usual stipulations.
So, Your Honor, if you would want to bundle them or do them separately, that's fine. The first one would be the item number four for a accepting the planning board's recommendation for the approval of the projecting sign with the stipulations.
Well, we need a motion with regard to the Fast Eddie's Dirty Laundry sign.
So moved.
Okay. And okay, discussion. Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
None opposed. It's unanimous. We'll just go through them.
Item number five, similar as the
so moved.
Planning director has indicated.
Second.
We have a motion seconded. Discussion. Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed. That's unanimous.
And the sixth item is similar as well. Odyssey and Oracle for property located at 82 Fleet Street to install a projecting sign.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed. It's unanimous.
Item number seven is a little bit more complicated, and I'll let Rick speak to that.
Item seven has been before you, came before you in September, at which time the planning board had recommended that it not be granted at that time because of some outstanding issues relating to the building and also to the operations within the building. And then over the course of the next few months, the planning board met several times to review this. There were, continuing operations within the building having to do with liquor license issues, but also there was a so-called temporary sign. It's actually a removable monument sign that was actually erected on city right-of-way on Vaughan Mall. And so when the application came back, it was for two signs, a projecting sign over the Hanover Street sidewalk and the monument sign, removable monument sign, on the Vaughan Mall right-of-way. Over the course of those few months, you can see we looked at this in August, October, November, and January. And by January, it was essentially all the outstanding issues were resolved. Because this area has been included in the historic district as part of the rezoning, the revision of the zoning ordinance, and because it faces the redevelopment project at the Portwalk area, the Parade Mall, the planning board felt it was important to have an extra review of these signs. And so in addition to the usual three stipulations that are recommended, the planning board has also recommended a fourth stipulation for both of these signs, that the sign design be referred to the Historic District Commission for approval. If you look at some of the illustrations and in the history of how this has evolved, you can see that the sign is a kind of very modern sign, and we want to make sure that the sign fits in with the investment that's going in across the street. And same thing with the monument sign on the Vaughan Mall. And then with respect to the monument sign, another aspect of the recommendation is that the license that is granted for that sign, if you choose to do so, would include the area around the sign. It's a sign, there's some lighting fixtures, some conduit under the Vaughan Mall, and some curbing and landscaping that has happened over time, and we don't know whether there actually has been any formal permission for that. So just to regularize that, we recommend that the license include that whole area, the sign and the surrounding area as well.
Thank you for that. Since it's a little more involved, and since we want to make sure that this gets read into the record, what the recommended action is to accept the planning board's recommendation with the aforementioned stipulations and approve the request of Ted Montzouris and John Ducey for the Page Restaurant to install a projecting sign and to place a removable monument sign, underground conduit, lighting fixtures, and surrounding curbing and landscaping on municipal property in Vaughan Mall at 172 Hanover Street, and further authorize the city manager to execute two license agreement with regard to this request. So if anyone cares to make a motion to do that.
So moved.
We have it.
Second.
We have a second. Discussion. We got some discussion. Councilor Dwyer, then Councilor Coviello.
I didn't understand the description of the monument sign being removable when the place wasn't open. It when I look at this schema we have here, I don't see how that works.
As I understand it, there is a permanent mount mounted in the ground, and the sign essentially just lifts off the mount, and it can be carried inside.
It's actually made of light fabric.
This sign that we see here is made of light fabric.
Yes.
Councilor Coviello. Follow-up, Councilor Dwyer, if we need it as well.
I'm sorry, were you done?
Well, I'm confused, but...
All right, we'll start, go with Tony.
Go with Tony.
Being that I'm now a member of the HDC, I'm wondering, is this in the spirit of the way that the applicant applied?
Yeah.
They applied before the zoning change, and I understand there was technical difficulties in getting the application through and all that, but I wouldn't mind it going before the HDC, but I wonder if it's in the spirit of what we are, the way we have our ordinance written.
Well, if I could answer that.
Rick, if you please.
Yeah, the HDC normally looks only at structures on private property. They don't look at structures in the public right-of-way. This is, both of these situations, the projecting sign and the monument sign are in the city's public right-of-way, so they would not normally be looked at by the HDC, but because the city is granting a license, it's essentially something the city is authorizing, and so what the planning board is recommending is that we take an extra look at it to make sure that what we authorize is consistent with the historic district.
So it really has nothing to do with the zoning change. It probably would have been done anyways.
Correct.
Any further discussion or inquiry? I'm going to go back to Council Dwyer for a follow-up, and then Council Smith.
Just remind us if an awning sign does or does not count against the amount of...
It does.
It does. So the awning sign that we see in the picture plus this sign both are within the amount of signage given the other signs that are already... We're just approving.
Well, one of the things that's kind of tricky about this is that we've never had a situation like this monument sign before. So we count the awning sign, and we would normally count the awning sign, the wall signs, the projecting sign, all within that sign area. It's not really clear whether we would actually count that monument sign within the sign area because it's not on private property, but we have done that, and it does fit within the overall sign area.
Okay.
Thank you, Councilor Dwyer. Any further discussion on this item? Councilor Smith.
Thank you. I guess I'm trying to figure out why all of a sudden we're going to have this go to the HDC when we have projected signs what we just approved that doesn't have that stipulation in there, and we're not having the other signs go to the HDC.
Well,
Mr. Tainter?
This issue did come up at the planning board, and I think the discussion was that the other signs that we saw seemed to be, from the planning board's perspective, didn't raise those design issues that that this particular sign raised. This one really stood out. It initially began as an internally illuminated sign, and the planning board had recommended to the council in August, and the council voted in September that it, if it were approved, that it would only be externally illuminated, not internally illuminated, because at that time the area was not within the historic district, and so therefore the requirement that it be externally illuminated was not in place. Now that it's in the historic district, that requirement is in place, but the sign design has remained the same. And there was just concern in the planning board that there were some issues raised by this sign that were different from other signs that they had seen.
Further discussion. Council Smith.
I have an issue with that, with this one stipulation. I just think we're just starting to over-regulate and get into it. I think, as Councilor Corviello brought up, you know, when they first, their intent to come in with this, it was even before the zoning ordinance change. I just think it's just more regulation on small businesses, especially if this starts to become normal habit. And is that really what the HDC is going to be getting into, is all these different signs and start regulating that much? They have enough on their plate as it is. So I'd like to make a motion to remove that stipulation from this.
Okay, this would be, let's.
So that would be a motion to remove it, if I had a second.
It would be a motion to amend by removing
Thank you.
That would be item 2 in the recommendations, right?
Correct.
Okay, so we have a second discussion on the proposed removal amendment, we'll call it. Councilor Dwyer.
I agree with that, because I think in this case, it's very difficult to separate the monumentality of the design of the sign from the logo that's on the sign. And so I think it's kind of, it poses that free speech issue of getting close to that area. So I think I would just as soon stay away from that.
Councilor Kennedy.
Have we ever done this before?
Have we ever referred something to the HDC before?
No, sign.
I know what you're saying, yeah. Well, we've only been doing this to my knowledge, as a regular pattern since last year. I don't think we've really done this formal process of referral. One thing that is common is every time a sign goes to the Board of Adjustment, as I understand it, it's common practice for the Board of Adjustment to refer to the HTC for review. So I guess that would be the parallel, is if something is going to another city board for a special permission, then it has been recommended to go to the HTC. And just for clarification, I'm not really sure whether we're talking about both the monument sign in the mall as well as the projecting sign, or we're just limiting our discussion to one of those. I'm not clear on that from the motion that was made.
The motion is to remove that stipulation to go to the HTC, period.
I have two on both of the items.
Okay.
And to both.
So he's clarified he's reiterated his motion to amend. Councillor Spear.
Thank you. I'd like to speak against the amendment. I think when I look at the signs that are before us tonight and the signs that we looked at in the planning board a couple weeks ago, it became very clear, not based on the content of the sign or even the logo of the sign, but the structure of the sign to me and to other members of the planning board was glaringly different. And at some point, now I'm very sympathetic to the amendment. I understand where it's going and I understand the problems we might entail if we take this approach with every sign. But to me, the signs were different enough that it merited a second look by the HTC, especially in this very visible area. So. And I'm very comfortable with the HTC being able to handle this, being able to tackle this type of problem. Like the planning director said, they get these referrals from the BOA quite often, and I don't see the challenge. I think, in fact, if we do refer it to the HTC and they require modifications to this design, it'll preclude other businesses from coming up with these types of designs that don't fit the character of the neighborhood. And all you have to do is look back with the other pictures that are in front of us and the other types of signs that you're familiar with downtown, and you'll see how they do have a consistent character for that area, and the proposed signs do not. So those are my reasons I'll be voting against the amendment.
Councilor Kennedy.
I actually have a question for Councilor Spears and yourself. I see the one up on top of the building very similar to signs downtown. Are we looking at the fact that it's the other sign? And maybe we should just have that portion go back to, and I'm thinking while I'm speaking, which is never a good thing, but maybe that portion is what we're all questioning. Because I think the sign that's up on the building, the oval, is very similar to the other signs that we've seen tonight. But it's the extra sign that everyone's having a question with.
I'm just going to put one fact inquiry out because I think it's right on point for this discussion, and Eric may want to respond, but the so-called monument sign is internally lit. Is that correct?
No, it is not.
It is not internally
lit. There are fixtures that are placed on the ground that will
All right. And is that is do, does that replicate itself anywhere else in the downtown typically?
I think there are a couple of those. I think the old City Hall has one like that. Yeah.
Okay. Well, all right. That's a good example. I'll go back to Councillor Kennedy made an inquiry. I don't know, Councillor Spear, if you wish.
The oval sign? I guess, do you mean?
The one that goes up on top of the building.
The awning sign.
The orange one.
It says lit bar.
Why don't we walk through the signs so that everybody's familiar with them? Why don't we start with there are photographs. Rick, why don't you walk everybody through each of the signs on the photographs, okay?
Okay, I hope I have the same images that you do. I have a page that says existing sign to be removed.
That's it.
Okay, that sign is going to be moved to the side of the building. That is not the subject of this request. There is a orange oval area there. That is just indicating a general location. It's not an oval sign. It's just showing the location, and the actual sign is shown about two pages on. It says D, face 5-foot by 3-foot projecting sign. It's a rectangular sign with brackets on the top and the bottom. That is the sign that we're suggesting should go to the HTC.
So there's not
confused.
A right.
I thought you were moving this sign up and it was going to look like the oval
shape.
No.
All
right.
The rest.
And it's not. And it might be that these signs are okay. It's just that it merits, in my mind, it merits another review. And the council, certainly I wouldn't want to make that call tonight, but it would, in my mind, raised the level of concern that I'd like another commission who's well-versed in these issues to take a look at it. That's all.
Okay, we've had discussion, further discussion on this issue. I'm sorry, Rick, did you have a comment?
I just did want to make a statement that tonight the Board of Adjustment is hearing a request for a variance from Portwalk across the street. And if they go according to practice, Portwalk will be required then to go to the BOA for review of their the signs that they're asking for variances for. So it's
You mean the HDC?
The HDC. So that would be consistent with this.
Okay, Councillor Coviello, then Councillor Kennedy, then Councillor Smith.
Rick, what about the awning and monument sign that say wet bar?
The awning sign is not over the public way, so that doesn't require any special review at all. It's an allowed sign. It fits within the sign area, so that's okay. The monument sign is also one that we had proposed having the stipulation that it be reviewed by the HDC. So stipulation number two in both of those license recommendations would be going to the HDC.
Now, if I may comment on the,
yeah, sure.
The answer. In my mind, I thought we were originally talking about the monument you sign. And right. So I said, well, I could look at it, make the visual interpretation that it's fine. That's why I was in agreement with the amendment, seeing that we're also talking about the projecting sign that isn't in place yet. I would be comfortable with that going to the HDC. I was just speaking about the monument sign.
Well, you may be speaking about it, but his motion was regard to both. So regardless of what your interpretation was, at this point, Councillor Smith has made his motion, and I think he's clarified it. So his motion to amend, which would remove that stipulation from both. So that's really what we're speaking to now, and unless someone seeks to somehow amend the amendment, and I'm hoping you don't. Okay. Okay. If Councillor Dwyer.
Well, you know, signs do take a long time. Someone has to explain to me in words, qualitatively, what design distinctions you see between this and Eddie's that you could actually explain to another person that says what, I mean, we gotta have words that say, this is why this one is different from the others, that says this has to go to the HDC and the others don't. You know, I can't see it myself. I also thought you were talking about the monument sign. So what are the words that say qualitatively in design terms, why is this an HDC one and Dirty Eddies or Fast Eddies isn't?
Rick, do you care to respond?
I would just say that I think that the typical projecting sign in the downtown is normally hung from a bracket, and it is usually a fairly light bracket, and it's usually a decorative sign. This one is fairly, you know, solid. It's not hanging. It's actually fixed in position, and it is on you wouldn't really call those fine, lightweight brackets or decorative brackets. They're really, you know, kind of square. So I think it's some concern about the
bracket.
The bracket and the relative weight of the sign, in a way, in the sign and bracket. Your point is well taken. It's always a continuum. It was just raised enough questions at the planning board that it came up.
So it's not the sign, it's the bracket.
No, it's the kind of construction of the sign, I think, more than anything else.
Further discussion, Councillor Kennedy.
After all this discussion, I'm going to vote against this amendment because I thought we were talking about the freestanding sign, which I do think needs to be looked at because it's not a traditional thing downtown. If we were looking at that, then that was one thing. I also am questioning the hanging sign. So,
Councillor Smith.
I'm going to be supporting my motion. After 11 years on the HDC, there's a lot of work that you get to look at. And you have to think about what is the mission of the HDC, and that's to protect the historic nature. But there are some things that change. Signs come and go with the businesses as they come and go. And we're just getting to the point where, in my opinion, we are just starting to overregulate every business for every little detail, and we're starting to drive the businesses out of the downtown. And now you're starting to see letters to the editor for come to Newington, come to Kittery, we're business happy. We're driving our businesses out if we continue to constantly berate them with regulations. And so I'm going to be supporting my motion.
Additional discussion on this point before we vote on the motion to amend removing those stipulations. Okay, everybody ready to vote? Let's do a roll call. because it would be hard to do it on a voice vote?
Repeat the motion, the amendment to the motion.
It is to remove stipulation 2 from each of the recommendations of the planning board under projecting sign and removal of monument sign, which the stipulation is to refer to the HDC for approval.
Okay, everyone understand the motion?
So we're voting not to take it to the HDC?
Well, no, no. He made a motion.
The motion is to remove that.
Is to remove it. So if you want it to go to the HDC, you vote no.
Okay.
If you do not want it to go to the HDC, you vote yes.
You ready? Assistant Mayor Noveling Glaber?
Yes.
Councilor Lister?
Yes.
Councilor Hetmanic?
No.
Councilor Spear?
No.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Coviello?
No.
Councilor Kennedy?
No.
Councilor Smith?
Yes.
Mayor Farini?
No.
5-4.
It carries or it fails?
5 opposed, 4 in favor.
Okay, so the motion, the amendment fails. We're now back to the motion in chief. Any further discussion or motion practice? Hearing none. Maybe we should make this a roll call vote as well.
Bon, I just got to write this down.
That's fine.
So it's the original motion.
Correct.
Okay. Assistant Mayor Noveling Glaber?
Yes.
Councilor Lister?
Yes.
Councilor Hetmanic?
Yes.
Councilor Spear?
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Coviello?
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy?
Yes.
Councilor Smith?
Yes.
Mayor Farini?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Thank you, Your Honor. That's all I have under my name. If there are any questions or comments. Is there another one?
That you have the donation.
Griffin, I'm sorry. Yes. Excuse me. I got lost in the weeds here. Yes, item number 8, the report back, donation of land from the Griffin Family Corporation. And as you recall, on December 21st, the City Council meeting, the Council reviewed an offer from Mary Griffin, president of the Griffin Family Corporation, to donate to the city a parcel of land on the Route 1 bypass. We have provided you with an aerial map of that. The parcel is adjacent to the railroad bridge and opposite the Frank Jones Center is almost entirely wetlands. The retainer has reviewed this along with the planning board with a recommendation that we accept the land.
Okay, we've had it explained. We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Discussion. Hearing none.
Question.
Oh, yeah, sure. Councilor Coviello.
I'm worried that I'm going to be stepping on some toes that I don't see, and I apologize ahead of that. I'm just wondering, what is the value to the city in taking the land?
The value, quite frankly, is it's now in control of the city. So in the future, it may or may not have somebody in the future might try to develop it. I don't know.
But I thought it said that this was not a developable property.
I have no knowledge on who might acquire the land next to it. I have no idea into the future. I don't know 10 years from now, 5 years from now, 1 year from now, what might happen. I mean, we can certainly tell her that we're not interested in it. I don't know what the future holds.
I understand. I'm just, the only reason I bring pause is we're taking money off the tax rolls.
We can let her keep it. All I'm saying is I don't know what's going to happen in the future.
I understand. Yep. So I just, my point is just for making a point.
Quite frankly, well, I know what your point is, and certainly we talked about that, but from our perspective, anytime we can have control of the land and encourage this, it's better for the community. Because as we parcel these together, it actually helps us in the long run, because we don't know into the future what will. Rick,
and
did you want
and
to
this
see
is
that?
Adjacent to other city land and can be managed together with it. And as the city manager said, there could be right. There's very little development potential, but there could be the potential, given the fact that it's being taxed, that somebody could find a use for part of it. And because it is such extensive wetlands, it would put pressure on the ecosystem around it. So it's nice to have a good buffer around wetlands and keep that area as much as possible, because we have so much marginal land that is being developed.
And again, it is a valid question.
Okay. At this point, do we have a motion to accept the recommendation?
So moved.
We have a motion. We have a second. Do we have discussion? Pardon me?
Pardon me?
I think we're all set. Ready to vote? All in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? That's unanimous.
And that's all I have, Your Honor.
Okay. Under my portion of the agenda, first we have resignation from William Gladhill from the Economic Development Commission.
Move to accept with regrets and a letter to thank him for service.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous. And these are all for consideration, and I'll quickly read through them so at least that they can be heard on television. Liz Boudreau for the Pierce Island Committee, Linda King for the Pierce Island Committee, James Russ for the Pierce Island Committee, John Simon for the Pierce Island Committee, Arlene Corovo for the Pierce Island Committee, Harold Hapgood for the Pierce Island Committee, Stephen Marison for the Pierce Island Committee, Robert Pollard for the Pierce Island Committee, Richard Smith for the Pierce Island Committee, Harold Whitehouse for the Pierce Island Committee, Anthony Blankensop for the Planning Board, Mary Liz Geffert for the Planning Board, William Gladhill for the Planning Board, Paige Roberts for the Planning Board, Peter Bresciano for the Taxi Commission, Frank Daggett for the Taxi Commission, James Feely for the Taxi Commission, and Joel Look for the Taxi Commission, John Connors for Traffic and Safety, Ronald Seifer for Traffic and Safety, Ted Gray for Traffic and Safety, and Brad Lown for Trustees of the Trust Fund. And I would also direct you, per that, there's a lot of applications in there, and I appreciate that. Note that these are for consideration. I believe we also provided, let's see.
What are you looking for?
The attendance.
That's at the next meeting.
Oh, sorry. At the next meeting, I will provide you with, the city clerk keeps a record, and we have the record of attendance, so you'll have that in advance. And so if people need to speak to me, they're more than, that would be fine, and we'll make sure you have that. Councilor Dwyer.
Now, since some of these are almost like whole committees being reappointed at once, I assume in some cases they're filling out terms so that we don't lose everyone on a committee at the same time, so they're staggered in terms of how they will get reappointed, or is that not necessarily true?
Not necessarily.
It depends on the committee.
Okay.
It depends on the committee, but Planning Board, they're staggering. I think less so for the Pierce Island Committee, but in the case of the Pierce Island Committee, there's also an interest in simply having more people. So, you know, it varies. And we will provide you with, in advance of the next meeting, that term information as well, so that you can look at those terms as part of your consideration for this. Councilor Caviello.
I would just point out that the attendance records are on the bottom of the sheets, as ones I saw.
Well, what we were speaking to is
an aggregate.
Is the at the end of each year we collect the attendance records for all the boards and commissions, and that information is coming forward at your next meeting.
Great,
so you'll have it.
Thank you.
So I guess we don't need any particular motion on that,
Your Honor.
If I could,
Councilor Lister.
I just think it's important for the members of the City Council to recognize all these people, and just so people out there who are watching this, some of these people have really stepped up to the plate to be active in the community, and many of these people have been on these committees for many, many years. So just I think it's important to acknowledge all those people and encourage others to step up to the plate and be active on some of the committees and commissions. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll move on to item three and talk about a Blue Ribbon Committee on Operational Efficiencies. A number of councilors have made inquiries about how it is that we can combine services and how it is we can realize efficiencies from doing that. And in the first instance, I think that it would make sense to consider appointing a Blue Ribbon Committee on Operational Efficiencies with city councilors and school board members to look at that very question for recommendation during the budget process. So it would be my intention to appoint that committee with probably three from each, and it would be, you know, a somewhat limited period of time that they would meet, but the idea would be to assist in the budget process going forward with input from both bodies rather than have it. I just think it's better process to have those people have an opportunity to have input, and there can be some staff assistance. So I would like to go forward and do that, but I would certainly like to hear comments and questions about that. And let me just also say what we can do is, as we get through that operational efficiency with the school board, we can then perhaps do it with other departments as well. So The reason I didn't think it would make sense to put everyone on the committee in the first instance would be because some of the questions are just askew and we didn't want to waste people's time. The school's the biggest department at this point, so if we do that in the first instance and then perhaps we look at the other, look at police and fire, for example, and consider some sort of hybrid committee there so that we can have some additional process. Does anyone care to speak to that? It's not a, I mean, I can go ahead and do it, but I want to get input and or counselors who are interested in serving. You know, you don't have to tell me now, but tell me soon, and we'll appoint some members. First, we'll go with Counselor Lister.
Thank you. Just a question. Were you thinking in this Blue Ribbon Committee, people coming up with strategies for this budget season?
Well, I think that it's going to have a longer fuse than that in terms of it's going to happen during the budget season. But I think that we're looking at a longer period of time in terms of the budget difficulties we're expecting the year after this budget year. So I think it's going to be a longer look.
And Your Honor, I think what was contemplated is that these would be aimed for the budget of 2012. Because anything dealing with some of the operational efficiencies that have been contemplated are going to have impact bargaining associated with them and a number of other things. So that was contemplated as we had that conversation at our retreat for 2012.
And to the, I mean, something may fall out of the trees, and that's good if it does, but we're looking at a two-year cycle of stuff. Councilor Kennedy.
I understand what we're trying to get at, and I understand and I respect what we're trying to get at. My concern is, if you don't have a big group, in other words, if you don't have someone from each of the groups, then how do you look at how you're going to work together and coming up with a plan? And if you only deal with one group, is it basically doing someone else's job?
I think we could do it in two phases. I think we could go in the first instance with schools, then perhaps police and fire. Then maybe once there are potential offerings from each, you could convene everyone in the aggregate and have that discussion. There are other ways we can look at process, City Manager.
Just one of the areas that I've been hearing about over the last year or so is the issue of the fields, you know, the combining the operational efficiencies there with also the buildings and those types of things. So that right now, that does not affect specifically police or fire.
Right.
That one alone would be a huge undertaking because of the number of the contracts that we deal with, the equipment we're dealing with. It would really be something that the school board itself would have to fully be on board with, because as you're probably well aware, when you start putting together the custodial services, the field maintenance, and all those things on together, you have to have full buy-in from both bodies, because clearly the principals of the school are going to have that be involved in that conversation, and the Public Works is going to be involved in that conversation. So it would be something that I think is going to, if that is something that I've heard is the major issue that people want to try to get at. And this committee might meet for a few months and say, geez, that's not what we want to do. And then I think, as the mayor indicated, that you would want to then continue to move on to other parts of the city operations.
Councilor Noveleen Clayburgh, then Councilor Kennedy.
I just wanted to say,
Assistant Mayor Clayburgh.
We all have seen how successful it's worked with the recreation department, merging the city staff with the school staff. But also, some people might not realize that we also did that with the legal staff many years ago in the school department, where a member of Bob's team, Kathleen Dwyer, works exclusively for the school department, but she's under Bob's direction, and she you know, works with him on issues too. But we saved a lot of money when we combined that job with what the city had. So we certainly have had success with it in the past, and I think it's definitely, this is a great idea, and I think we should go ahead.
Further, Councilor Kennedy.
Maybe it should be based on, maybe there should be a strategic plan around the issue of if parks and recreation, the combining of that, that should be how the committee is formed. Who's going to be involved? Who's going to be involved in that issue? If it's legal or if it's bringing back services, then those versus just saying the school department and the council is going to set up a committee to work on what's going on. In this, you know, I guess I would like to see it a strategic plan around a certain issue, and whoever's involved comes to the table and supports it, and maybe we need to look at those issues and kind of come up with another plan for those issues or a strategic plan about the issues that we see. But I think that there would be a lot more.
Well, I'll bear that in mind. Any further discussion? Council Dwyer.
Very simple, just a nomenclature thing. You really are talking about combined services, not all operational efficiencies.
Correct.
Because I wouldn't want to get on a committee and start dealing with
No.
Just to be real clear.
Correct. I think that's a good point. That's a good point. Further discussion? Okay. Well, those of you who have an interest, talk to me and we'll firm it up and bring it back. I have nothing further under my agenda, and we now turn to Councillor Spear and the referral to him of the for the Committee on Downtown Events. Councillor Spear.
Thank you.
You have a report in your binder.
Yeah, the memorandum sums up our findings, and there's an amendment I'll talk about in a minute. We had three meetings. The first meeting, let me first about talk about the charge. We were charged by the mayor to find the pros and cons of downtown events and the impact of such events on downtown life and economic activity within the city. And we try to look at the broader picture, not just of the money that these events bring into the city, but also the diversity and flavor that it adds to Portsmouth life. The first meeting was to go over the current practices. That included the current administrative process for how groups get into having an event, in whether it's on public streets or even on private property. We reviewed the events calendar. We talked a little bit about how the previous events had run successfully or not within the city. And then we realized we needed a place to gather public opinion. So we did it in three ways. We had a website on the city website dedicated to collecting opinions. We had phone number, obviously, people could call, and Nancy Carmer, who was helping on this. And we, for our second meeting, we had a public input session in the evening so that people could come in and talk about events within the city, you know, as broadly as possible as they envisioned them. And we did have a few speakers. And that's also not to forget that the committee itself was made up of people who, from the entire spectrum, were very plugged into events within the city, both as business owners or as residents or as promoters of certain events. So it was a very good committee in that respect as well. Thirdly, our third meeting and third and last meeting, all committees should endeavor to have three meetings and then dissolve. Our third and last meeting had, we were able to synthesize all of the comments people had made and the process by which we approve events and manage events within the city and come to findings and recommendations for the council, which you have before you. The most important takeaway from this exercise we did was that of the input we received 79 public comments. Of the 79, three were opposed to one or more events, which is amazing. On my time on the council, hardly anything has the unanimity of that type of opinions. So the message was loud and clear. We need to continue these events. Now, we may endeavor to manage them more effectively, and I'll talk about that later in the recommendations, but overall the message was keep them coming. We do have administrative process for events management, and for the details, I'll refer to the city manager after I speak, but essentially the event coordinators, the various city staff, and the various departments, fire, police, come in and have a meeting to make sure that everyone's on the same page and the events will proceed smoothly. And I'd like now to go over a few of the comments. You have in the memorandum, we had kind of the, I guess, for each comment, we had the theme that it's addressing. Later on, there's an appendix which has all 80 comments, which you can read at your leisure. But I just wanted to give you a sense that it's not just bringing in dollars or it's not just one issue we want to bring in. The first one I thought was really good. The events contribute to a sense of community and local diversity. you know, even if you're not particularly interested in fish, having the fish festival adds something to the fabric of the community. Even if you're not interested in the Bow Street Fair, it adds something to the total is bigger than the sum of the parts in this case. And that comment touched on that. Obviously, events boost exposure to the city and increase visitation to downtown Portsmouth. People from all over outside of Portsmouth would write in and talk about that. The economic impact is there. Many commenters talked about how much money they spent when they came in. Another thing we have to remember is the events themselves are often quite affordable entertainment. And for people who want to enjoy the city, may not have deep pockets, but many of these events are very affordable. And many of the events are reasons why people choose to live and work in Portsmouth. They make the specific conscious choice that this is the place to be due to these events. I do want to touch on, there were some, like I said, there were some negative comments. And of course, the number one issue, as you might guess, would be parking, of course. Street closures was also a negative event or negative impact, and people wrote about that. Some people were concerned about the unreimbursed expenses from the city for either public works or police. And I'll let the city manager talk on that later. I think it's my understanding that a lot of those are reimbursed. And of course, some people were concerned that the street closures would negatively affect businesses. Let me go to the recommendations. Like I said, most of the people around the table, most of the people speaking, thought the administrative process the city goes through right now is successful, and we encouraged that we continue that. We did recognize there was we could improve the city's website to explain the process better, so when people are from out of town, maybe they aren't familiar with it, they can look at the city's website and get a sense of, okay, these kind of the things you should keep in mind when you go through the process. For street closures, we do advocate a 3-month advance notice to kind of manage when you have too many street closures in the same weekend, give us a chance to space these out. Significant holy days are an issue. We do have quite a few places of worship within the downtown that we want to successfully work through. Again, promoting public transit, and that's been a success. I know that one event, I think it's Market Square Day or the Criterium, I can't remember which one, Market Square Day, uses the Fox Run Mall as satellite parking successfully. And so we want to continue doing that. And again, limiting the number of street closures to the extent possible by using public venues such as public parks and other parking lots. So that sums up my report back to the council. And again, if the council's interested, the city manager could go over the process that he works with the staff and any reimbursement issues that people might be curious about.
What we do is once the city council authorizes me to move forward, we contact the individual, make sure that that they have the ability to get the insurances that are required. What we do is we offer them to come in, or we do it by telephone. We bring police department, fire, public works. We try to bunch it together so that it's one place where they can ask the questions and everybody is fully aware of when the event's going to take place. Typically, the police department, depending on the event, will indicate what type of coverage they're going to need, and they do pay for that coverage. Fire department in the larger events might assign an ambulance. We only have maybe 2 or 3 of those a year in which that happens. So it's usually about a 10 or 15 minute meeting, but it's very important that everybody from various departments is fully aware, highway, garage, the parking, so everybody is on board. And again, we try to make it as convenient as possible for the individual. We'll do it by telephone, or if they wish to come in, we'll have them come in. And if they have any questions offline, we can then specifically have the police department maybe deal directly with them. And that has happened in the past when they need a little bit more conversation with the police department. So that works very well. With regards to reimbursement, we typically get reimbursed for all the events. What will happen is if there's a small event that might need a couple barricades out, we'll put them out during the day. We'll lay the barricades down in a certain spot, and the volunteers can put them out, so Public Works isn't coming in for any overtime on smaller events. And that's pretty much the extent of it.
Questions for Eric or John? Council Coviello?
Just on item six on the recommendations, just so we can be very clear on this, to the extent possible, limit the number of event street closures, by using venues such as public parks and public and private parking lots. I'm sure it's not the intent, but I wanted to be clear that we're not pushing people out to Pease, for example. I think we want to keep this downtown.
I don't think that was the intent.
Right, that was actually, that concern was mentioned at the committee. That wasn't the intent of this. This was more, if council, it's kind of along these lines. When we're often asked to hold events in Market Square, we suggest Vaughan Mall as an alternative
or
place.
Bridge Street.
And so it's more of a, we want them to be successful. We want the vitality of the events to continue to be in Portsmouth in the downtown area, but it's just a way of looking at alternatives.
Councilor Smith.
Thank you. Two comments, really. One is, was it looked at, or is there any policy thought of that limits how many events you can have going on at the same time? It seems like there are sometimes we get into a weekend where we'll have, you know, three or four or five events happening at the same time. Was there any discussion on limiting?
We thought about that. The trouble is, different events can have, can be so different in their character and the location of where the event might be taking place. So, for example, Music Hall might have an event that just closes Chestnut Street in that one area. Another event might be somewhere else in the downtown that might affect only a very limited part. And so by quantifying, you can only have five events in a weekend, it didn't work. And so by looking at how different all these events were, I think the committee came to the conclusion that really you have to go through this process that the city manager described. That's when we can see all the pieces together and how the events might or might not successfully interact. And I think the city manager wants to add on to that.
And I think the Councilor Spears has expressed what the committee's concern was. But the one weekend I think you're describing is the one we had last year. And that was an aberration because of there was one event that we could have canceled, but we felt because of how far they went forward with their advertising and everything, that it just would have been very counterproductive for that nonprofit. So, and also we had a new event that started last year in that same day. We're cognizant of that, we're aware of it, and we're very mindful of it, and that's something we're going to watch very carefully into the future.
Thank you. And second comment, if I may, more for the city manager, and that is a lot of the bike-a-thon, walk-a-thons, so forth, they put up their signs, you know, arrows, so people know the routes. And there are sometimes, days later, those signs are still up. Is there a fee or something if they don't take down the signs, because I'm assuming DPW then has to go out and clean that up.
Right. No, but we could explore that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Further discussion on this report? Well, I would like to thank you and the members of the committee. Councilor Spear, it was thoughtful, and clearly you did put a lot of thought and effort to it, so I appreciate your bringing it forward to the City Council. I also appreciate that you undertook that in the middle of a campaign, at the end of the year, et cetera, for a quick turnaround, because, of course, as you know, as fellow councilors, we have a lot of people requesting events, you know, into the new year. So much appreciated. Any other comments? If not, we're on to item 13, miscellaneous, or unfinished business, Councilor.
For miscellaneous or unfinished
sure.
business. Probably one of the biggest things I've been getting phone calls and calls on over the last week or so has been the $5,000 parking impact fee. I know we've sent a message on to the planning board for report back. Just if we can get a feedback on when that'll be coming back to us so that we can start looking to that.
Right. And I've asked I've talked to the planning director. I've asked him to expedite that back to the city council.
Thank you. Because
I understand. We understand.
Thank
you. Councilor Kennedy.
I actually had two questions. One being, I've been getting a lot of feedback on the Paradev parking lot, and I was wondering, I've been told by a couple community members that there was some overlying trust or ordinances on that piece of land, and if I could have a report back maybe of what, is there any legal nature there, any kind of on the deed restriction, any kind of information on that. And second, the Portsmouth pool, has there been any plans or any thoughts about in the closing of that pool, what might happen to a swim team with the fact that we have four other pools in the city. And maybe a little outcome of that, or a little forward thinking of what the city has thought about for that.
Yes, if I might, Your Honor.
Well, I'm going to have the city manager, we want him to speak it. I just want to say that with regard to the pool, that's a proposal that's come forward. We vote on the budget. So, I mean, it isn't a proposal. It's something that's been discussed, but city manager can speak to it.
I think Councilor Kenny makes a good point. And as part of my budget presentation, I would have, unfortunately, and I apologize if people felt that the information got out ahead of the budget, but, you know, dealing with recreation boards and different people and staff and the like, it's just an unfortunate circumstance when you have the reduction in force where my main intent was to make sure city employees that are going to be affected heard about it first. Then my next step was to make sure that the recreation board heard about it. And it's part of the budget process. There'll be other recommendations in the budget too that will have these similar types of effects. We have been in discussions with the YMCA over the last couple months to talk about the idea of utilizing their pool for the swim team. We asked the Y has shown us there's seven communities in the state that have Ys, not only in New Hampshire but in Maine, that utilize the Ys for their swim team. So we're in those conversations. So that is something we're doing and something we'll be talking about as part of the budget process. But it's an excellent question. With regards to your other inquiry on Parrot Avenue, the city attorney will work and he'll put together a report back for the next meeting.
Councilor Dwyer.
It seems like a long time ago since we had the retreat, but it was only a little bit ago. I want to follow up and begin the conversation on something that we all talked about actively there, which was city charter amendments. And just want to bring up and question what we should do next in order to, I think we all understand, or it seemed to me that there was consensus that it was the amendment line that we were really talking about as opposed to the whole restarting a whole commission. And so would we do a work session? Would we bring forth as individuals under our names things we'd be interested in? What should we do next?
John, do you care to offer a suggestion?
I do recall, and Bob, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the last time this was being discussed, what happened is, as Bob described, the mayor had set up a committee, but because we didn't have as much time as we probably would have liked at the retreat, it would probably be useful to have a work session so that the mayor can get input as to how the city council wants to proceed, and it also is something we can televise as well. So that would be my recommendation, because the city attorney then could reiterate his presentation so that the public could have that comment, and then the conversation could then evolve from that.
Okay.
And we really didn't have time to deliberate, and no. I think a work session would help okay. in that sense. So, Councilor Lister.
Very quickly, just to go back to the pool issue, when Mr. Bohanko comes back to us with recommendations, maybe if that's the process we're going to follow, will we have a chance to talk about those, about the pool?
Sure.
The reason I'm asking that is, we're all getting phone calls, there's no question, and the pool is a big issue in the city. The whole issue of childhood obesity and exercise and the pool is used a lot. I just want to make sure we have an opportunity.
And those numbers, we'll be talking about that. You know, we will be talking about the usage and the cost and the number of residents and non-residents using the pool. Mm-hmm. Believe me, you're going to be talking about a lot of other things I'm going to be proposing too, right. So which may include reduction in force. So it's a matter of how we're going to get at what the city council wants, and we certainly will have that conversation. And the community, if the community and the city council feel that this is an expense that they want to undertake, clearly we'll do it. It's just a matter of we're trying to bring forward a recommended budget that has the least effect on our citizenry, and that's what we're in the conversation right now with various department heads. This has substantial savings and it has limited impact, but there are those that would counter with what you just said, and so that's a legitimate conversation.
And just for the record, remember, when in doubt, look at this teal page in the front of your book, and those are when the work sessions are going to be, and if we decide we need to have more discussion, we will. But we are going to, you know, for example, April 22nd, municipal budget. That might be a time to talk about some of these issues, because that's what we set as an agenda when we set this back in time. Councilor Kennedy.
Yeah, but, I mean, I guess to have those discussions, and I think we should. I mean, I'm in favor of using the Y. I mean, I was an avid swimmer. I swam all through college, and I did a lot of my swimming at the Y, and a lot of my competitive swimming, and I actually even at one point even coached at the Portsmouth Pool. But we need to have those discussions as a group before the when we're all hearing about the information and the discussions. Right now, you are putting us in this predicament because we're getting all these calls.
Do you care? Are you making a suggestion of change in process, or?
No, I'm saying that the discussion now is not going to take until April. So I'd encourage us, you know, if we're going to bring all this to light, then let's figure out when we're going to do it and bring it to light and have the discussion at the same time or the recommendation. That's all I'm asking.
John?
Your Honor, I can appreciate your constituency having concern, but, you know, as we go through this major restructuring within our government, which we're going to be doing, at least that's what you told me you wanted done, as a city manager, I need to have a hard look at my recommendations. And they are just recommendations. If the council chooses, they could keep the pool open an additional 6 months in that fiscal year to have more deliberation on it. But I felt it was important because it's such a draconian, let's face it, what you laid out to us is pretty draconian, and that's fine. But what I needed to do was I had to look at a major service, and unfortunately, just because I wanted to make sure my employees were informed and that the Recreation Board, which I work closely with, was informed, that these things get out. Now, the council, when it goes through its deliberations, might say, okay, we think this has legitimate reasons to close, but what we will do is we'd like you to come back to, you know, maybe keep it open additionally. Those are the things that are on the table. But at some point, the council has a major policy decision in front of it, which it will discuss, and if the council says, no, we think the community wants this, and we want it, and we can. And the only reason that I would suggest you keep it in the context of the entire budget, you haven't seen the entire budget yet.
Yeah.
So, you know, you could have such a severe disruption in, let's say, revenues because of what could happen externally, the state, for instance, we don't know. So all I'm saying is, yes, I think it's important that we have a full and vigorous discussion on any of the proposals that are in the budget. It's just that I think it's important to have in the context when you have everything together, because you're going to have all your revenues, you're going to see what the impact is. It's like a company looking at its end of the year statements, and they're going to be saying, geez, you know, how was our profitability? And this is going to be something you're going to be looking at with your revenues as well. So all great questions. I'm open to it. Believe me. It's one of the hardest decisions that I've had to make in 32 years to make that proposal, and I'd welcome you to reverse it, to be honest with you. That's all I'm saying. It's one of the toughest things that I've had to do, and again, I'm open to have a full discussion on this, and there'll be other discussions I'm sure we're going to be having on other parts of the budget, and I appreciate your comments. They're well thought out and well put.
Councilor Kennedy.
I'm not disagreeing with having the discussion, and I think that I'm glad you're putting all this stuff forward. All I would like is that it comes forward in a time, and that maybe at the same time it comes forward, we say, but there, we might be able to use the YMCA pool.
Okay, fair.
Versus
fair enough.
Just being put out there, and then no possibility for response, no possibility for discussion, no possibility for maybe there's other ways to do
it. But that was brought to the Recreation Board where it should be brought first. It's a recommendation. When it gets to you and becomes your budget as a city council, then you have the opportunity to say, okay, let's bring in this and talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
Right now it's the city manager's budget that is working with the Recreation Board, and quite frankly, in the conversation with the Recreation Board, I did have a thorough discussion relative to the why. So we did have that. When we're building a budget, especially now with all these different areas of cutbacks, there are going to be people that are not going to be happy, and that's just a reality of life. So I'm responsible, as you've directed me, and as and per the city charter, to bring you a recommended budget. I will be delivering that budget to you sometime in April. Once I deliver it to you, it's your budget. Those recommendations can be changed, amended, added to, taken away. That's going to be the prerogative of the city council. And you'll have until the end of June to do that.
Thank you. Any further inquiry or discussion? Councilor Dwyer.
I think these opportunities, if we can remind people that these decisions haven't been made yet, and we are looking at information, these opportunities can be chances to maybe ask more pointed, specific questions. You asked us to write to you lists of questions that by Friday, I think. And I think in some cases, you know, I was attacked myself several times over the weekend. They do offer an opportunity to understand what misunderstandings might be out there and what ideas people might have. And each rationale is a little bit different. And if we can figure out what the question is behind those, that we can, you know, ask you, for example, you know, some people think you can do this just on fees. Well, I'm going to ask you, what would the proportional fees have to be for the resident users and the non-resident users to actually, you know, what would people have to pay for us to operate as we operate it? So if we can make these into questions that will then help us say to somebody, okay, no, you probably don't want to pay, you know, $3,000 to use our pool or whatever it is. That helps us to put it in a different way. It would be helpful if members of the public could think about that too. And the other thing I decided after reading things this morning is every time I get attacked like that, often, by the way, by non-residents of Portsmouth, I think I specialize in that, that we ask them, all right, so where would you make the equivalent cut? So that we're not just accumulating all these reasons what we can't do, because we know we got to get there eventually. And I think what we often don't have the dialogue about is to say, okay, so you want the pool to be open. Well, what would you suggest? Because we may get some ideas. You know, I mean, everybody's talking about these things, which is actually, I think, very helpful.
Thank you, Councilor Dwyer. Councilor, Assistant Mayor Noveling-Claiborne.
I just had a couple of phone calls regarding the pool where people seem to think that it might be a good idea to try to fundraise, you know, try to raise money to maybe keep the pool open. So I think there are ideas floating around out there, and it might be an opportunity for people in the community to get involved. So I think there is some good discussion going on.
And we certainly encourage that. So thank you all. Any further issues to pop up here?
I have one thing.
Assistant Mayor
Noveling-Claiborne. This is just a point of information. I just wanted to let everybody know that our new counselor, Bob Lister, jumped in the frigid Atlantic Ocean for the 11th time last Sunday and raised a lot of money for Special Olympics.
Bravo, Bob Lister. Great. So with that, I'll entertain. We'll entertain. Thank you. Good for Bob. Anyone care to make a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
None opposed. Thank you and good night.